There's no doubt that the Toyota 86 has become a very popular chassis for all sorts of motorsport, but there's only a limited number of 86s that are competing at the upper ends of Time Attack. We're here with Josh Coote from MCA Suspension with his Toyota 86 that's running in the open class. It's pretty wild. It's fairly far removed from the stock FA20 and the stock 200 horsepower that that engine produced. We're here to find out exactly what makes it go. So Josh, obviously when you want to go fast around a racetrack, the 200 horsepower from the FA20 is not really going to cut it, but you've been down a fairly long and elaborate development path with the 86 chassis. Can you talk us through your first range of modifications when you started circuit racing?
So to start with, this car was completely stock. Just did the usual things, you know, suspension and tyres, exhaust and a tune, and away we went. And it was an excellent car, and it was really fun to drive. And then I started thinking about doing some World Time Attack stuff with it. I went down the turbo path with the FA20, and I wasn't a massive fan of the lack of drivability that I was getting from it, coming from the NA setup. So I ended up putting a VQ37 into it, natural aspirated VQ37 from a 370Z. And I really, really liked that setup. That was an incredibly fun car to drive. It just had a nice boost in horsepower, but still natural aspirated. The reason I chose the VQ37 was I'd actually wanted to put an engine like that into one of these for a while, because it's three cylinders long, so it's not overly long. You're not sort of completely ruining the weight balance of the car, putting in like an inline six or something like that. So
like one of the common options we do see there is the Toyota 2JZ that's been done to death, and particularly in Formula D in the States. So the length of that inline six compared to the VQ37 and even the FA20 just upsets the weight balance?
Well, I mean, yeah, anything's going to upset the weight balance, even the VQ is going to, it's just about minimising that upset, in the search for proper horsepower.
So in terms of the VQ37, when you were running that, obviously you've moved well above that now, but so what sort of power level was that producing?
The VQ? The VQ37, to be honest, I'm not 100% sure. I think it was around about 300 horsepower at the wheels or so. And for the lap times it was doing at the time, it was incredible. It was pretty light. It weighed about 1170, I think it was. And it was an excellent car to drive. But I saw the lap times and I saw the potential, and I thought, okay, well, maybe let's go to the next step. And having already put the VQ in there, the VR38 was an obvious choice because, very, very similar physical dimensions. So we knew it would fit in there easily. And the performance potential of that motor is almost limitless in a way. So it was a no-brainer to go down the VR38 path.
So is this just simply because of the development we've seen in the R35 GTR community with that VR38? Gives you more options and it's cheaper and easier to develop than the VQ37?
So the VQ37 isn't made for turbos, and when you're wanting to make 1,000 horsepower, the block just isn't really strong enough, in my opinion. I also like to build cars quite reliably, strong and reliable. I don't like having to repair things and rebuild engines all the time and lots of stuff, so I kind of wanted just to do it right, do it once, the VR38 was the obvious choice for that.
Okay, so you mentioned 1,000 horsepower there. I'm guessing that is the power mark you're at. Can you let us know what you needed to do to that VR38 to get that sort of power? Obviously, again, in the GDR community, we're talking street car numbers here, so not a big stretch.
Look, it was pretty straightforward. I just did a really basic engine build. Just put CP and Carrillo helped me out a bit on some rods and pistons. We got head gaskets in there and some head studs. Kelford from New Zealand gave us a hand with some cams and valve springs. And then BorgWarner helped us out with some turbos. I can't remember the exact model of it. Relatively small, about 500 horsepower each turbo. Together with the motec, and it just sort of worked, and it was easy, and it's made 1,067, I think it is, at the rear hubs, and it's a nice amount. I could definitely do with some more. It seems strange to think that, but there's definitely room for more. I want to keep it reliable, and so I feel like that's sort of the sweet spot for maximum horsepower while keeping the reliability. In the future, I'd like to consider a billet block path and then go pretty crazy with it, look for like 1,200, 1,500 horsepower or so, because I think you could still keep it reasonably reliable, and also drivable. Something for the future perhaps, but I'm happy with how it is now.
with those turbos that you're running, the smaller BorgWarner EFR, I mean, when they're known for their great response anyway, can you give us some idea on what the power band is? When are you seeing full boost on it? And for that matter, what sort of boost pressure are you running?
I should probably know some of those things. The boost, I think the peak boost is maybe just under 30 PSI. As far as when the power comes in, it does come in relatively early. I'd say probably around about the four mark. You're starting to see, you know, a fair bit of the power, and it carries it through reasonably well. It does start to taper off a little bit towards the top, it works well for the gearing and for the track. And like I said, the main thing is I wanted to try and keep it drivable, because when you've got rear-wheel drive, the drivability of the motor is key. And we've actually spent a fair bit of time on tuning the way the boost works. We are running full boost in fourth, fifth, and sixth. But in first, second, and third, we've dialed the boost back a fair bit to try and help with the power down, because at those speeds, we don't have the aero helping us quite so much. And so, getting the power down can be a bit of a trick.
Now, obviously, in terms of World Time Attack competition, the power is only a small part of the package, and aero is really another key aspect. You've got a fairly wild-looking aero package on the car. How have you gone about developing that, and how critical has it been in the times you're getting out of the car now?
Yeah, obviously aero is a massively important area. Last year we did a little bit of aero with Andrew Brilliant, and for what it was, I think that worked really well. But this year, they've changed the rules a fair bit, opened up the rules, and we can do a lot more with the aero. So I wanted to sort of go from real head to toe and sort of redo the aero package. So for that, we've brought in Barry Locke, because he's a local guy to us up in Queensland. And so I think it was a bit easier to work closely with him to develop the package, and he could also oversee the implementation of the parts, make sure it was all fitted up properly, strong enough, all that sort of thing. So we've changed we've got a whole new front under tray. We've got some hammerhead style winglets there now. We've got some side skirts, which have got some diffusers built into them as well. And we've carried that through to a rear diffuser also. So on top of that, we've been able to raise the rear wing up, which is still an Andrew Brilliant rear wing. And the overall package is working exceptionally well this weekend. Obviously we're up seconds over last year. I think the track's probably not as good as it was last year as well. And it's just incredible now going into turn one. It's really just a game of how brave I am. Yeah.
In terms of getting some data on that, have you done anything around validation, or is it really just a case of seat of the pants feel that the car's better or worse with changes in the aero?
So we did have some potentiometers on there, and we do have some data on that. To be honest, we haven't really sort of had the time to sort of look and study that. We do have it there when we do get a chance to, but for now it's just been a case of some of the aero parts only went on a few days before we sort of left Brisbane for here. And so, a lot of it's just been, seat of the pants testing, trying different spring rates, different valving, and just to get the setup right.
Well, ultimately, you're running in second place in the open class now, so whatever you're doing is clearly working. There's one more session to go, so best of luck with that session, and hopefully you might be able to knock a little bit more off your lap time. Thanks for the chat there, and we look forward to seeing your progress.
Yep, thanks very much.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.